Good evening, everybody. And I'm here, Agam Vora, chess physician from Mumbai, your governor for West Zone Chess Council of India. And I bring to you today a very interesting discussion on vaccination. Oh, what could be a better topic to discuss about vaccination than today? There cannot be any better time to talk about it. You every day, I'm sure everybody here must be getting at least 20 phone calls asking about vaccination. Do we take it? Yes, no. Which vaccine is better? Do we take Covaxin? Do we take Covishield? If we get choice, we have fever. My uncle's aunt's neighbor got this reaction. My neighbor's auntie's uncle got this reaction. And I'm on anticoagulants and I'm on so on and so on and so on. And I feel I must record the answers, you know. And play it every time anybody calls up to chuck, oh, is it about vaccination? Listen to this music. But no, we end up answering that, those questions. Not only that, there are so many questions that bubble up in our mind. Is it really true? And there cannot be any better panel than what I have today to talk about vaccination. I'm extremely happy to present to you the excellent panel. And I have Dr. Samaria with us. Dr. Samaria is senior consultant chess physician. He's an ex-professor and head of Department of Chess Disease Institute of Medical Sciences at BHU Varanasi. The treasurer of Indian Chess Society, honorary secretary of SARC, Association of Chess Physicians. My personal favorite, and I take this opportunity to tell you that it's been more than two decades that I've had the pleasure of his blessing, his love, his affection, and he's guided me on various occasions. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. I welcome Dr. Samaria. Dr. Shashikant J.U. Shashikant is a senior consultant, Department of Pulmonary Medicine at Chegatri District Hospital, Davangiri. Hi, Shashikant, I welcome you. We have Narayan Pradeep. Narayan doesn't need any introduction. He is a very active member of Chess Council of India, the brain behind Chess Council of India, one of the right hand of our president, my Dr. N.H. Krishna. And I welcome Dr. Narayan Pradeep here. He's his consultant, Respiratory Medicine, District TB Center at Kasaragod Government Hospital, Kerala, and a chairman, trust board member, Chest Council of India. I also welcome Dr. Radha Munje. Dr. Radha Munje, again, needs no introduction to our August gatherings. She is professor and head Department of Pulmonary Medicine at IGGMC. Is the president of Vidarbha Chest Association, very active member of Chest Council of India. Anybody who's active on CCI platform knows that madam is always there to give her active inputs to any discussion which is going on. I have Ravi here. Ravi, my close friend for another decade or so. He is DNB, DTCD, respiratory medicine, consultant and pulmonologist, head of department, respiratory disease, SIMS, Indore, and a national general secretary of Chest Council of India. Ravi, I know him for, as I said, more than a decade and is very actively involved into COVID management, has treated N number of cases. He himself got victim of COVID, but in spite of that, his spirit still is very active and he's with us to discuss about COVID vaccination. Before I begin this panel discussion, I want all of silence. 2 seconds silence for those 130 million cases globally. 2.84 million deaths across the globe. 12.4 million cases, active cases in India with about 164,000. My Maharashtra is heading. It is topping. It is on one of the top lists for COVID-19. We have 2.9 million active cases in Maharashtra with more than 55,000 deaths. And that is what is the number. We did not deserve this deaths. We does not deserve this kind of morbidity. A very small 100 nanomicron virus, probably somewhere 15 months ago in a small city of Wuhan, China, which threatened mankind and has challenged our existence. We, supposed to be the most developed species on earth, are challenged by this small virus. And this 15 months taught us many things. We realized that probably, you know, we need to really sit and think and look at what we've achieved in this probably so-called journey of last couple of thousands of years, and we tried with everything possible. We tried controlling these viruses with you know, those anti-helminths, multivitamins, trace elements. Then came the old drugs. We started repurposing those drugs. We looked at newer drugs. We looked at our old friend steroids. We looked at biologics. We looked at newer antivirals and whatnot. It took us almost 6, 7, 8, 9 months to realize the right treatment. And we understood the treatment. We probably developed the vaccines, and probably there came the second wave. We failed miserably in controlling this disease across the country, and we are facing this second wave. I was talking to Dr. Munjay, and I was under the impression that second wave is relatively milder. I was under the impression that this particular bug that I'm seeing now is more infectious, but leading to less casualties, leading to less complication. But she corrected me in saying that this wave is not as simple as what I'm thinking. We are going to be seeing more number of complicated cases. We are seeing more number of morbidities, and all our hospitals, all our ICUs are going to be packed with only COVID. I hope this doesn't turn out the way Madam says. I hope this particular wave turns out to be milder. I think the history is repeating itself. When I look at COVID, it reminds me of my journey of tuberculosis. You know, more than 125 years of correct TB treatment knowledge, and we are nowhere. Disease is like probably coming with vengeance to us, you know. The minute I thought I know about tuberculosis management, the minute I thought, yes, I can control tuberculosis, the minute I thought, oh, so many investigations available and tuberculosis is going to be, you know, click away, it came up with drug resistance, it came up with multi-drug resistance, it came up with total drug resistance, and probably the history is repeating. I'm seeing COVID also behaving in the same way. Hope, like any other viral diseases, in no time, we win this particular disease with vaccines. At the way I thought, now probably developing herd immunity will be easy. I thought the minute 50% of my population is getting vaccinated, disease will under control. Somehow I feel, this is my personal opinion, I feel we could not handle the vaccination properly. We started giving vaccination at the same place where COVID was being managed. We started giving vaccination to elderly patients, to people with comorbidities, and healthcare providers only at the place where COVID was rampant or active COVID cases were managed. We could not somehow have the proper distancing, the proper protocols to give them vaccines. And that is probably one of the factors which resulted in the kind of cases that we are seeing. At least 30-35% of the new cases that I'm seeing have taken one shot of vaccine, have been to one of those facilities to get this vaccine, and they are developing COVID. Is this vaccine related? Is this poor facility related? Is this poor management that we had related? And so on are one of those questions which are bubbling in all of your mind. And I'm going to do this today. I'm going to take up all those questions and probably put it up to the elite panel that we have. If you have any questions, put it in the chat box there, and we would love to answer all of them. To begin with, Samaria sir, let me begin my panel discussion by asking you. You're the senior most here, and we want to get the best out of you. About this vaccination. So do you think it is the right strategy to vaccinate only senior people and only healthcare provider, or you feel everybody should be vaccinated? You think the strategy that we have chosen about vaccinating only the people with comorbidities or only with you know, healthcare providers is working well? Your views. Dr. Samaria, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Agambora. It is, in fact, it is advisable to get the vaccination to all. It is like, but it is difficult to give all the vaccine. You cannot vaccinate 135 crore people at one shot, at one time. So you need to be differentiate. The healthcare person, those who are at highest risk should get the first. So healthcare personnel were given the first phase. then followed by the people who are more than 60 year, then followed by the more than 45 year plus with the comorbidities, and now we are giving the 45 years. So it is the right strategy, because availability of the vaccine and the vaccine given modalities is also required to be at hand to deal with such a huge problem and huge population.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Madam Munje, I always felt that, since day one, when I was in talks with the task force here and when the strategy was being developed, of course, I'm not part of it, but then we were having informal discussions. We were thinking, I was of the opinion that vaccination should reach to patients rather than patients coming to the vaccination center. And I was of the opinion that we must have the ambulances, we must have the vans, we must have the healthcare professionals going to these societies and buildings and those places and vaccinating them. What do you think? What is the right strategy? How are these residents of nursing homes and other long-term, caregiving facilities being vaccinated? Do you think the strategy that we are following is right, or you would want to make some other suggestion? Dr. Munje, please.
Yes. Dr. Agam, what you say is what the time we need. It's a demand of the time that such facilities should be extended to these nursing care facilities also. But the most important point, if you look at the vaccination and the efficacy of vaccination, the science behind it is that the proper temperature of the vaccine preservation must be maintained. Luckily, the two vaccines which are available in the country needs to them to be preserved at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade, which even a common refrigerator can allow. Another important thing, and I remember there was somebody from CCI group only who had posted that it is not only the preservation of the vaccine till it goes to the center, but even when it is handled by the person who is giving the vaccine to the patient, to the person, not the patient, till that time also the temperature should be maintained and that chain should not be broken. So the question comes that are we equipped enough to take all these care? That is the first question. If all this can be taken care of, then I absolutely agree that all inmates of various nursing care facilities or even the old age homes and all should offer the vaccine at the site rather than these people traveling to the vaccination center. Apart from it, you have to remember that the healthcare professional or all those who are giving services in these centers must be vaccinated on priority. They should not and cannot act as spreader in these nursing homes, because all the people who are inmates here or are living here are very susceptible either due to age or their comorbidities, or they are not active enough. They may not be able to even communicate few of the mild symptoms which they get. So these are two things, and you have to find out if the facilities can be provided, a care to maintain the temperature of the vaccine to ensure the efficacy can be taken. Yes, I agree with you that these facilities must be extended there. As of now, we do not have, but I remember that it was announced that care would be taken that if somebody cannot go to the vaccination center, the nearest vaccination center and the staff working there should go and give the vaccine at home also. And I think some type of formulation or regulation of this would, or a guideline rather, would come in a shorter period for all this.
Thank you, madam. I have a question for Dr. Shashikant. Dr. Shashikant, would you tell me about the differences between these two vaccines, the Covaxin and the Covishield? What is the basic difference between these two vaccines? Are you there, Dr. Shashikant? Oh, I don't see him. Dr. Aryan Pradeep, would you want to take this question? Would you tell me the difference between these two vaccines, Covishield and Covaxin?
Basically, if you see it, one is a shield vaccine or a
Inactive and, vaccine, yes.
Yeah, inactive vaccine, that is what. Yes. Another one is we will give it with the some other vector. That is the vector basic difference.
Yes.
That is the basic difference. And if you see the data, initially there was some confusion, which is good. Now, again, we are seeing it is more of a co-vaccine is more favoring. So I feel there is both are good equally. It should be good, induce good immunity. And we should not much concentrate which is one we are getting, which one we should discriminate. It is not like I am getting vanilla ice cream or chocolate ice cream. So I feel, yeah, basically the concept should be like get vaccinated. Because we have to vaccinate 135 crore people. So our idea should be to get vaccinated with the proper dosage, with the proper vaccine. And we should...
That's a great message, Dr. Pradeep, you gave. That a lot of doctors and a lot of healthcare providers have their different ideas in their mind regarding which vaccine is better. You know, there are different technologies behind these vaccines. You know, there are more than 135 vaccines which are registered, more than 90 vaccines which are in the active phase of understanding. And you have various ways in which these vaccines work. You know, you would be surprised to know that the vaccines could work on various ways, you know. You have virus-based vaccine where virus is inactivated or virus is weakened. Then you have a nucleic acid-based virus. You could have a DNA virus and an RNA virus. You could have a vector-based virus. That is, you have a this adenovirus there. You have weakened measles virus there, which could be replicating or non-replicating. In the sense, these viruses in the system could replicate or it may not replicate. You may also have a protein-based virus where virus only subunit or virus like particles are made, and there are ways and there are various various epitomes on viruses. Every antigen is called epitome on the surface of virus, and it has a potential to induce antibodies or immune reactions in your body. So depending on its capacity to induce immune reactions, the vaccine efficacy is judged. So you have viruses based which are inactive, and you have a viral vector based vaccine. So you have these two vaccines available, that is Covishield and Covaxin, and it works on these two different mechanisms. And yes, what Dr. Narayan Pradeep has said, I completely agree with you that whichever vaccine is available, I believe it is your duty. Currently, it is every citizen's duty to take vaccine, because you're not taking vaccine for yourself. You're taking vaccines to improve herd immunity of my country. And till 55, 65 to 75% of the population do not take vaccine, will not be able to control COVID the way we want it. And hence, Dr. Pradeep's message is absolutely pertinent that whichever be the vaccine, one must take it. That makes me ask Dr. Ravi Doshi. Ravi bhai, what do you think? What should be the spacing between these two vaccines? What should be the ideal spacing between two vaccines? You know, we began with the idea that vaccination should be given at 28 days. That is 1 month is the ideal time. Then we realized 1.5 months. Somebody is talking about 2 months. Somebody is talking about 3 months. Somebody is talking about booster after 6 months on vaccination. What your personal ideas about the right spacing between two dosages of vaccination? Dr. Doshi.
Thank you, sir. Basically, the initially what was told was that it should be a difference of a month at least. And that is why most of our vaccinations, initially we had 3 weeks apart, and then we were made to take it 4 weeks apart. But now the newer guidelines tell it for 45 days minimum gap between the two Covishield vaccine shots. Moderna shots can be given at gaps of 21 days. So basically the antibody response, which is elicited by the first vaccine shot, the second vaccine shot acts as a booster to that. So most of the vaccines are starting from the 21 day to a highest range of around 60 days. So ideally what the recommendation as per our guideline now is a gap of 45 days between two vaccine shots. That will give you an optimal booster response. Unmute.
Oh, sorry. So the ideal duration is what is about 6 to 8 weeks, is Dr. Doshi saying. Is that correct, Dr. Doshi? That is what you said?
Yeah, that is what I'm saying. Yes. That is what the recommendation is.
So the task force and the various states decided about giving it at the four weeks gave was more of convenience based on what was available at the data which we got with the first vaccine or even the availability of vaccine. But as we get wiser, we now realize that ideal spacing should be at about 6 to 8 weeks gap. And if possible, please space it at about that time. Dr. Munjay, you are saying something?
Yes, I was saying even there are studies which say that it can be given at an interval of 12 weeks, but we have as of now adopted it to maximum of 8 weeks interval between Covishield, whereas for Covaxin, it continues to be the interval of 4 weeks for a booster dose.
Great. Thank you, madam. Dr. Samaria, sir, we've heard that certain vaccines would require only single shot. Your views on that, and would you recommend, do you think that single shot vaccine is better than double shot vaccine or triple shot vaccine? Because now we are getting some news that if you have taken Covishield, maybe after the gap of 3 months or after the gap of 6 months, it may be wiser to get a booster dose of that, a vaccine which requires only one shot. So your views on that. Samaria, sir, you may have to unmute.
In fact, single dose gives the immunity safety up to this 70%, 70-72%. At some say it is 74%. So whatever it is, but single dose vaccine is boosted to the 84% by the single second dose when it is given 8 weeks interval in Covishield, and in Covaxin it is 4 weeks interval. But there are now single dose vaccines are available. Say a Johnson & Johnson vaccine is available, but which is not approved in our country.
It's not available approved, with us yes. Also. Yes, true.
It just received the approval from the US FDA, the US for giving the US. But I don't think it is very advisable to go for such type of vaccine. We are having indigenous vaccine, good vaccine, and we should depend on our vaccine only.
Sir, if I may ask you, since you said about efficacy, what does the efficacy actually mean? Does this mean your chances of getting infection, or it tells you about chances of developing antibodies? I mean, how is this evaluated? Would you please tell us about, when you tell me about 70% efficacy, what do you actually mean by this?
In fact, it is the trial they did, trial results of the trial, that 100 people have received the vaccine, and out of which 70 may not develop the, and 70 will develop the antibodies against the vaccine, against the virus.
Thank you. Dr. Munjay, madam, let me ask you the extension of this question. Is the antibody titer really relevant, or you think it is mainly the memory cells which probably get the inflammation, and when there is reinfection, it's how your immune system would react is more important than the development or the measurement of antibody at this stage? What do you think is more important?
Ideally, to see for the efficacy of COVID vaccine, you look at the antibody titers, and especially the RBD antibodies, those which are against the spike protein. They are very important, rather than looking at the IgG levels, which people are doing nowadays. Those antibody values actually cannot predict the protective effect. That is one. Second is, few of the people may not develop antibodies and may have cell-mediated immunity. But my own personal experience is, whatever cases which we are seeing now, who have received the vaccination, either the first dose or even the booster, and then develop disease, I feel we should go back to the basics of any infective disease and look at not only the protection offered in the form of the immunity which they have developed after vaccination, but you should look at the viral dose which is coming, the mutations which the virus have undergone, and a particular time when the person is exposed. Totally, if you are unprotected and not with a COVID appropriate behavior, I believe that you receive such a large dose of virus that you do come up with disease. And we can, in spite of having good amount of antibodies, protection against infection cannot be guaranteed. That is my personal opinion.
Great. Yes. We have Dr. Sashikant here, who just logged in. Dr. Sashikant, we were discussing about certain vaccination and the immune reactions, etc. And in the discussion, I want your opinion on a lot of patients do ask about doing these antibody titers. You know, they get anti, they probably, all those who got vaccine, who got disease, or who probably had a case in family or who's taken vaccine, would come out and show me those fancy reports of total antibodies, and somebody would come and show me the spike antibodies, and somebody come and show me some funny various antibodies, and I don't really know how to interpret them and the clinical relevance of that. Dr. Sashikant, I thought this would be the right platform to clear my doubts, and I want your opinion on that.
Yeah. Right now, we don't have any specific guidelines over the antibody titers. Many patients, many of our friends, they come with such type of reports, and still they may ask even to take one more booster dose, but that is not there in the guideline, and we have to go with the government guidelines, first dose and second dose as per the guidelines. That is indicated, not the antibody titers.
Great. Dr. Samaria, you are a very senior physician there, and I'm sure a lot of top shots, politicians and high-end patients, and would bother you every day and night to ask about these queries. They have taken vaccine and they got their total antibodies done. Total antibody titers are zero or probably not detected or insignificant. How would you explain them? How would you tell them that this is not really relevant? How would you explain them the yes, probably if at all, the spike antibodies may have some relevance? Your views on that?
In fact, it is not the antibody which is important. Dr. Radha Mujhe has already said that antibody titer may not be very important, but right, it is the T cell immunity which is important, I think.
Yes.
It is. So whenever there is T cell immunity is there, which is there after following the vaccination, you are protected. Antibody titer may not be very important in such type of patient.
So do you recommend any patients to do get their antibodies done, or you think it is not really required?
No, it is not really important.
Oh, great. Fantastic take-home message. I want every delegate here to understand that antibody titers are not relevant, and please remain away from asking those antibodies. You know, it's like your gynecologist colleague asking for those funny tests for tuberculosis, microsure positive. And you get those references, and then you, what to do, you know. It helps you only in getting references. Otherwise, those patients would have never seen you. Thanks to that MicroShare, you get those patients, and you can, you know, probably put your visiting charges and then write down AKT not required. Probably exactly this is the situation now. When you get these reports, please pay no attention to these reports. And Ravi Bhai, a lot of these patients, you know, they get this pseudo-confidence. When they take this vaccine, they realize, now I don't have to worry. I don't have to wear masks. I don't have to maintain social distancing. Now I'm protected. How far this is true? Ravi Bhai, your views on that. Do they really still need to wear masks? Do they really still need to follow social distancing? And if yes, why?
I'll start off with a small story. A patient came to me with an appointment, and as is the story, we usually have vaccination centers and hospitals at the same places. So it so happened that the patient also brought along senior members of his family for vaccination while he came to show for a COVID infection. And the very same car, and they came and visited me. And surprisingly, the senior members of his family were not wearing masks. We are coming for vaccination. So it defies logic at times as to the extent that people are taking this. But again, you cannot preach. You can only hope that they understand that vaccination gives immunity. It in no ways acts to stop the chain of transmission, which is aerosol spread. So wearing a mask still remains very, very important. And lot of mild to asymptomatic cases nowadays present with a very strong pharyngitis, and they cough quite a lot with their dry hacking cough. And even when you go to most vaccination centers, you find that they are usually lot of coughing going around in that
correct.
Duration.
Correct.
So wearing a mask is very, very mandatory. And nowadays, like in Indore, the weather is very, very hot. People, even the staff sitting at the vaccination center, find it very difficult to wear the mask all the time. But it is mandatory because the designated centers are very few. The population at helm is very large. So wearing a mask, I think, still is the first vaccination against COVID, and then comes the vaccination itself.
Great. Perfect point.
Can I add something, Agam?
Yes, madam.
Yes. You were talking about that we should be having a COVID appropriate behavior in spite of getting vaccinated.
Correct.
Right? And Dr. Ravi Doshi has already underlined so many things. But for all of us to understand, we have to understand that whatever data we have about vaccination is that it offers protection against severe forms of disease and not absolute protection against getting infected. Right. So you have to wear a mask to protect yourself is first. Secondly, if you are a symptomatic carrier, you are likely to give it to your family members or colleagues. So you must wear a mask. And then you may be amongst those 5 to 10% of cases who have not been offered any protection by the vaccine, which is known in the literature. And you can never point out which of them are protected and are not. So it's absolutely essential and absolutely important to underline it again and again that vaccine is available. So yes, you must get a vaccine. And in spite of vaccine, the use of mask and COVID appropriate behavior is absolute must.
Correct. Who better than we chest physicians understand this? You know, BCG vaccine, we have for decades, centuries together. And see, what have we achieved? We have achieved nothing. It can prevent the severity of disease, but it cannot prevent infection. Vaccine is not a shield in front of your nose. The virus would still enter your system and would still elicit a disease or still elicit immune reaction. Only thing is, if you're vaccinated, if you have better immunity, probably disease may not go from mild to moderate to severe.
Or you
probably
may continue to be asymptomatic.
Yes, we have influenza vaccines for years in place. We have pneumococcal vaccination for years in place. But still, we do get serious cases of pneumonia in those patients who are vaccinated. We do get influenza in those patients who are vaccinated. So it's not a foolproof thing, and one must not remain, or one must not get that pseudo confidence that you would not get disease. Samaria, sir.
Yes.
So you have a patient who got COVID a couple of months ago, and though you did not ask him, but some of the friends and friend's friend told him to get antibody titers done. He got his antibody titers done. The antibody titers are high. And he comes and asks you, sir, do I need to take vaccines? What would be your answer?
Yes, it is always advisable to go through vaccine schedules. He is advisable, we must advise him to take the vaccines as scheduled, because it is not known how long the immunity will last. It is not known how long he will be immune, how long he will be developing the, he will not be developing the infection. This is what is, and this booster vaccine will further boost the immunity, further make this strong against the incoming infection.
Correct. Dr. Sashikant, what are your views on this? If somebody has enough antibodies, say total antibodies, he got it done, and antibody titers high, say 10, say 15. Of course, various labs give different kind of titers. I would say that above the normal level or good levels he has, what would be your explanation to him? I may tell you, sir, but I have good antibodies. Do I really need to take vaccine? And how would you explain this to me?
Still, we have to go with the vaccination. Because that titers of antibodies doesn't prove that he is immune to the disease. So even if the person has got active disease, after treatment, after 4 weeks, 4 to 8 weeks, it is advisable to take vaccination. Even then,
as both of the senior members said here, it is required. You know, there are various types of antibodies in the system. You could have a neutralizing antibody, or you could just have a reactionary antibodies or reacting antibodies. And we have not much understood about these antibodies yet. It's just 1 year old disease. And we cannot have the entire information on vaccines. What we have realized is there are vaccines which has identified a particular epitope of that antigen, and there are antibodies which develop against this particular antigen or against this identifiable locus on the virus, which may be whole viral vaccine, or which may be a weakened virus vaccine, or which may be a subunit vaccine, or whatever type of vaccine it is. And it is eliciting a particular antibody response, which is a protective response. So many a times what IgG, IgM, etc. antibodies that we do may be a reactionary antibodies and do not much understand about it. So I think we would be wiser over next couple of years to understand whether these patients require vaccine or not. But as of now, yes, what both the senior members said, that is Dr. Samaria said and Dr. Shashikant said, as of now, every patient must take their vaccines. Great. That makes me ask the second question to Madam Munje. Madam, tell me, if somebody has got COVID disease, okay, somebody is COVID suspect or somebody is confirmed COVID, say about 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago, when would you tell him to go for vaccination? Or do they require vaccination? Or would they be given vaccination? See, I give you a couple of scenarios. I have a 30 years old boy who got COVID and currently does not fit into the criteria for receive vaccination. Would you consider him as a special case and recommend vaccination for him? Or would you ask him to wait till the recommendations come for 30 years old? And second, somebody who's got COVID, say I had a fever and I'm a COVID suspect 3 weeks ago and I fit into the eligibility criteria. When would you recommend me to take vaccines? Dr. Munje.
Whatever evidence that we have as of now, if somebody has suffered from COVID or even was a suspect, the vaccination should not be given before 4 weeks of the developing symptoms. That is first and foremost. After 4 weeks, you can plan to offer him the vaccine in whichever bracket he fits. For your example, what you quoted as somebody who was 30 years old, even if I want to offer him a COVID vaccine, as of now, the guidelines do not permit or facilities do not permit me. And why we are offering a vaccine to them is, as Dr. Samaria has already underlined, we do not know that the immunity which the patient has developed after getting the infection, how long it will last, that we do not know. And even if he has that immunity, that needs to be boosted up by giving a vaccine. So that is why the vaccine can be offered anytime after 4 weeks. He can take even after 6 weeks. If he was ill for a longer duration of time, I myself would recommend that the day he becomes asymptomatic, that should be the day when the immunity has started developing in his body. And so even after 4 weeks, after that can also be calculated and vaccination can be offered.
I completely agree with madam. Does the panel have any different opinion? I completely agree with madam. You know, it is true for any illnesses that you have when we talk about vaccination. You have a case of pneumonia, you have a case of influenza, you would want to wait for about 4 weeks because you know that when they get disease, the immunity is suppressed and you do not want to give any immunostimulant at that time because antibody response may not be adequate and you would want to wait till the patient gets back to his normal level of immunity. And I believe 3 to 4 weeks is the standard time where they get back to their so-called normal immune state, and that would be the ideal time to vaccinate.
We even do not know whether there would be any complex immunological reaction to provoke if we give this vaccine too early and patient is yet not out of that disease or the suppressed immunity phase.
Correct. Ravi bhai, you were talking a lot about plasma therapy and you were talking a lot about patients who received IVIG therapy or immunoglobulin therapy, and during our previous discussion, you did mention about a lot of centers trying this. Now, somebody who's received plasma therapy comes to you for advice regarding vaccination. Would you deviate from the standard advice of 1 month, or do you would want to advise him to wait even longer? Or are there any contraindications to vaccination if patient has received plasma therapy?
Well, as far as plasma therapy is concerned, the antibodies provided by it will have their usual duration of somewhere around 4 to 6 weeks, usually. And that too, if you are giving a really good high antibody titer plasma to that particular person. Now, there are no fixed guidelines as to this or fixed recommendations as to this. So, what usually...
Problem is, unless you say guidelines cannot be made, so we are making guidelines. Aapka statement will be recorded there, you know. We are recording everything.
Yeah, I know, sir. That is why I'm trying to speak very diplomatically in saying that I don't know. Nobody knows. But I think four weeks is the proper answer. That any illness post 4 weeks, you can go ahead and go get yourself vaccinated by whatsoever modality you have been treated with. That is what I would say.
Correct. Narang bhai, Dr. Narang Pradeep. Yes, madam.
And for those who have received plasma, they receive at least 2 doses. and vaccination can be deferred even for 3 months, you know, because you do not know which type of what is the level of antibodies as well as the other immunoglobulins which may be there in the plasma.
Actually, that basic question came up several times, ma'am, and we had a lot of discussion with our hematologists and our pathologists also when we came up with this question, because a lot of our recovered patients started and posing this question to us.
Yes.
So again, the problem is the antibody titer measured currently doesn't very actually correlate with anything at all. It doesn't correlate with your immunity. It doesn't correlate with how much you are immune to the disease or how much immunity you have gained from the plasma. So what we had a discussion on the same topic with our pathology and hematology departments. So what they told is that usually you can consider yourself saved from disease nearly 2 to 3 weeks after receiving the plasma. But after that, automatically the antibody titer given by the plasma naturally weans off. So it's not like plasma is not a vaccine. It will give you an immunity for almost 2 to 4 weeks maximum.
I completely agree. Naren bhai, what is the basis of this plasma therapy? How does this plasma therapy work? What is this plasma therapy all about?
Just actually, Dr. Ravi has more experience than me, where he has given more than thousands of people he has treated in Indore, and it was the first center to get recognized in India for plasma therapy. But it is giving the same like antibodies, those who are from the recovered people, and hoping that these antibodies will act against the infected virus. So that will neutralize the infecting virus. That is the
great
basis.
Perfect point. Ravi bhai, correct me if I'm wrong. You know, I was under the impression that when somebody receives this IVIG therapy or plasma therapy, you know, you get ready-made somewhere around 3 trillion antibodies. Say, suppose you have, every individual will have about 3 trillion antibodies in them. That's the average count. Now, most of these antibodies, say 99.whatever percent antibodies may be similar to those insults that you face daily in life. But those .00% could be very specific. That Ravi bhai may be visiting his farmhouse in Indore somewhere, and I may be in Bombay somewhere. I may be going to Aksha Beach, you know, those conferences every time. And you know, I may have some specific antibodies which may be different for Dr. Samaria, which may be different for Dr. Munje, which may be different for Ravi bhai, which may be different for Dr. Naren Pradeepa. And when you take a couple of such normal, so-called normal individuals, pulled sera, and when you take derive IVIG from there, and you make a combination IVIG 100 so-called normal patients IVIG and push it into some patients who's got immunocompromised disorder, it gives them ready-made antibodies, and it gives you passive immunity to fight against those non-specific infections. That is what was told to me by Mohanty sir when we started using IVIGs for various disorders. I'm talking about 2 decades ago, and now we have come to probably understanding that there are specific antibodies, and when you use it for COVID kind of patients, you take it from COVID recovered patients. So Ravi bhai, will you tell me from where you get this plasma? Who is the right candidate to get this plasma?
Well, usually before you select a person for giving plasma, you need to do his antibody titer level. And the antibody titer level above 12 usually is a good plasma candidate.
You mean total antibodies or IgG antibodies or various antibodies?
Usually IgG is what is taken into account. So they are good convalescent plasma donors who have a good antibody titer level, and they provide you this immunity ready-made. But again, like you told, it isn't the therapy of choice. See, even plasma therapy patients tend to have a mortality, they tend to have morbidities. So they do provide you ready-made antibodies for a period of 2 to 3 weeks. The maximum benefit is nearly 48 to 72 hours post a bag of plasma. After that, automatically the antibody levels start going down. They do not induce any natural immunity in you. That is why they are safe. They are not immunogenic in you. IVIG, how it works, there are several proposed actions: immunomodulation, direct antiviral therapy, pro-inflammatory cytokines are inhibited by it directly. Again, it does not induce antibody by itself. It is not immunogenic. The antibody immunity provided by IVIG lasts for 24 to 36 hours, depending on the
passive immunity. Yes.
So both these therapies, I do not feel, have any long-term or any substantial role on vaccination or its outcome per se, neither do they tend to affect it. That is all that I can say.
So by and large, 1 month's time sounds absolutely rational for advising vaccination to your patients. Thank you. Ravi bhai, that was very nice information. And now I have a patient called Roshni. She has five family members who were tested positive. Two of them had serious disease. They live in the same house. And luckily, she did not get any symptoms so far. She's 6 months pregnant. Shashikant bhai, she comes to you asking for your advice. Do I get vaccinated? What would be your advice? I understand she is young, 35 years old, first pregnancy, not meeting the criteria for getting vaccinated, but she's known to Dr. Munje, and Dr. Munje is very influential there. On one prescription, anybody, even a 10-year-old child can get vaccinated. So she goes to madam. But before she goes to madam, she wants your opinion. So she asks you, Dr. Shashikant, do I get vaccinated? What would be your answer to her?
My answer will be, we have to go with the guidelines only still, as per the present guidelines. So from 1st April, we are going to vaccinate all the people above only 45 years. And in pregnancy and lactation, there is not much data. So that's why pregnancy and lactation, it is still not considered in the guidelines. So I personally would not recommend.
Can I add something to it?
Yes, madam. Patient is anyway going to come to you. You will have to only opine.
No. I was referred to in that question. So I take the onus of answering also.
Yes, ma'am.
What Dr. Shashikant says is very true. And what Agam says is also equally true, because people are so aware about the vaccine, so curious about it. And many of them really want to get it, though there is a vaccine hesitancy also, which we are observing now. And for these pregnant females, as of now, we do not have a safety data. But because of this webinar, when I was reading, it was said that if there is a healthcare worker who is pregnant and who is likely to come across more number of cases and there is more risk of getting infected, and if she is willing to take a vaccine can be offered to
pregnant people. Thank you very much, madam. I wanted this answer from you and I wanted this answer from everybody. See, now with, so much of strict ethics committee and so much of, difficulty in including patients who are pregnant or children into this clinical trials, but we do understand vaccination must be offered. And especially this time when there is physiological, situation where patient's immunity is low. And you have, I was part of the influenza vaccination guidelines when it came to its utility in pregnancy. And now every gynecologist has understood and is convinced beyond all that influenza vaccination can be given during pregnancy. And they are in fact promoting vaccination during pregnancy. It is a time that we understand that yes, vaccination must be given if situation allows, if you have the feasibility, if you have the influence as Dr. Munje has there, and if you can offer this vaccination to your patients, there cannot be any harm in recommending vaccination to pregnant women. Dr. Samaria, I would want to ask you, when I was reading this literature, it tells me that probably it requires a couple of years before a vaccine is developed. It requires almost a decade before you identify the locus, before you identify, the target, the potential against which the vaccine can be developed. You require about almost 2 to 3 years to understand the safety and immune response of the antigen that you're trying to study. And then you have about 5 years to understand its influence on immunity on, mices or various other animals before you consider it for human. I believe it takes about 20 years before a vaccine is developed. There are almost 6 stages of development when it is about vaccination and the timeline for vaccine development. These vaccines have come out pretty fast. Do you think that would be safe? And how could we developed vaccine which has come up so fast, Dr. Samaria?
Yeah, it has come out very fast only because we have already previous knowledge of the SARS virus in 2002-2003. We are having already knowledge about the MERS vaccination we developed. So similar type of the virus, similar type of the situation. So we already know the safety measures about the virus. So we started the second phase of the trial, and third phase was completed within 6 months of time. So it is ready because we have already knowledge, prior knowledge about the virus, this type of the virus, this type of the situation. So it is possible to develop so early the virus vaccine.
And the vectors which are being used for these COVID vaccines are same for other vaccines like influenza or rubella, and the same vectors are being used here also. So we already have that safety data of that, and then we have to see the whatever is the safety data with the combination of these two when it is being administered. And it would be important for all of us to see that the vaccines which have been well studied in phase 3 only has got permission to be used. And vaccine like Covaxin was in under EUA till we have our own data of safety which was generated during this vaccination drive in the last 2 months.
Madam, you spoke about these vectors. Will you tell us about what is this whole business of vectors? Somebody tells me that there are adenoviruses which are from the chimpanzees' stools, you know, they are developed. And it could be adenoviruses which are non-replicating. Somebody tells me that there are measles viruses, which are replicating viruses on which there are certain vaccines which were developed, like Ebola vaccine. If I'm not mistaken, Ebola is the one which is replicating viral vaccine, which is derived with weakened measles as a vector. And Zydus is working. I mean, it's going to be our vaccine, Indian vaccine, which is again on measles as replicating viral. So will you tell us in detail how does this vectors work? What is this vector and what is this weakened vector and what is this non-replicating vector, etc.? Could you tell us in detail about it?
Yes, I am not a basic scientist, so I would give a parallel picture. Everybody has seen the launch of space stations. How does it go? So it is launched from a particular place, and when it goes to the orbit where it is supposed to rotate, and then the space shuttle is launched off from there. Till then, a carrier carries this space station or space shuttle till that border of the orbit. Similarly, when a vaccine yes.
Nobody could have answered it better than you, madam. That's what makes you a Dr. Mujer. Come on.
That is what I have understood, that the vectors which we are using are actually carrying the material which is going to induce the immunogenicity or cause the immunological reactions to produce antibodies. Now, these vectors can be, as you said, adenovirus from chimpanzees, or it can be lipid nanoparticles also, or it can be adenovirus which is loaded with the spike protein.
Correct.
Or it can be the nanoparticle along with the dead COVID virus itself. And when it is given in the vaccine, it would be circulating in the blood. But the carrier is not active. That is very important.
See, what I understand about this viral vector vaccines is, yes, this is like you have a measles virus, you have adenovirus, which are genetically engineered. And they're genetically engineered in such a way that it can produce coronavirus proteins once they enter the body. And they're weakened. So these viruses are weakened. They cannot induce disease. So measles cannot induce measles disease. Adenovirus cannot induce adenoviruses there. And the viruses could be of two types. One is that can multiply. That means it could be a replicating viral vector where it enters the cell and replicates. And then there are certain non-replicating viral vectors like adenovirus, what we are using now in Covishield, that it cannot multiply because the key genes in that are disabled. So to give you an example of replicating viral, I said it's about Ebola virus. We have the technology in place where you have an Ebola virus which is weakened measles as a vector, and it enters into your system and it is immune response, and probably you have immunity to it. Now we already have the technology in place. Now this adenovirus, non-replicating viral vector, it's a new technology. We don't have any previous vaccine which is designed with adenovirus there. And for this COVID, this is probably this technology has come up for the first time, and hence probably we are a little skeptical about it. And Johnson & Johnson is working on this particular technology for non-replicating viral booster. So that's the rough idea that I have about vaccination. That makes me ask you the next question. And a lot of patients come and ask me that I have had mild disease. I did not require any treatment. I recovered completely out of it. And probably only those zincs and those supplements did wonders to me. That means my immunity is good. Do I need to take vaccine? Dr. Naran Pradeep, do you think this patient require vaccines? If so, why? Dr. Pradeep.
Some small network problem is there, sir. Can you repeat the question?
The question is, I have a patient who's, say, 45 years old, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, non-smoker, non-alcoholic, has got very good immunity, has got very good build. He had 5 COVID patients in the family. All of them had, moderate to severe disease. 2 of them require hospitalization, but he got only mild disease. He recovered without any antiviral treatment. He recovered without any doxycycline and azithromycin. He recovered without any ivermectin. He recovered only on zinc and vitamin C. And now he comes and asks me, do I need vaccines? My immunity is so strong that, so many family members got it, but I did not. That means my immunity is good. Do I need to take vaccine? Your views on it.
Yeah, sir. Actually, from the April 1st onwards, the guidelines have changed that everybody above the age of 45 should take vaccine. Anyway, before answering the question, I would like to thank all the doctors. I can see 980 logins today, and it is being the Sunday evening, and we have got so much. All the doctors have joined this webinar. I should thank for the time you have spent and the belief you have kept in the Chest Council of India for this webinar. And I should thank Dr. Samaria sir, Radha Munjim madam, and Ravi Doshi, Shashikant, and Agam Bora sir for making this wonderful evening, Easter Sunday evening, really very wonderful today with the discussions.
It's so, only because of your presence, Dr. Pradeep. I was there in the last couple of meetings, but nobody attended. So I think it's only because you are there today, it makes adds flavor to it. No?
Anyway, the guidelines are actually very changed from the April 1st onwards, that they should tell that exactly above the age of 45, you should take vaccine. And we should go with the government guidelines, and I should recommend him to take the vaccine. It is like he may have got the infection earlier and he would have recovered well, but we don't know what will happen in the next event. It's like when you are racing a car with so much fast, every time we'll don't know. So it is better to follow the guidelines and take the vaccine. That is my message to him.
Correct. Perfect message.
Question, I think each of the login delegates which we have must be facing at least once or twice in a day that such patient comes, the scenario which you have told. And it's for us, all of us, to emphasize that even if you have had a mild disease, even if you have a wonderful immunity, still vaccine is needed and recommended and should be taken after 4 weeks once you become symptoms.
Correct.
Basically, that we should not miss the jungle for the tree. I should not confuse whether that is what the basic take-home message. You should take the vaccine.
Correct. Perfect.
The person may be very much having good immunity, but he may be, the person is at risk of spreading infection to others. So that's why the immunity is
there. Sashikant bhai, the $1 million question is, we are missing you in between. So you seem to go away sometime in between the discussion and you come back. I just wanted to know that Sunday evening, what other thing is occupying you?
Nothing, sir, nothing.
No, your smile tells me that you're hiding something. At CCI, it's a big family and you can't hide anything. You have to reveal all secrets.
No, sir, I got it some other work, but I'm here only. There is some problem. Network.
Sorry?
Your question, no, I tend to explain it like that if you have a good immunity, then you should go ahead for a vaccination first, because that vaccine will help you become immune to the disease earlier. So maybe we need to promote healthier people to get vaccinated more.
Interesting point. Now, say you have option of getting vaccine. You know, in Bombay, and I'm sure in various hospitals, in various cities, in various states, this must be true, that a couple of hospitals are offering both vaccines. You know, you have a Covaxin also available and Covishield also available. Of course, where I went, there was only Covishield available and Covaxin was not available. My personal preference is for Covaxin for the simple reason that I like the technology better. I think the whole Viron may be a better, antigen or a better, could elicit a better immune response. And hence, I wanted to take Covaxin, but unluckily, to all the places where I work, Covishield was available. I took Covishield. Now, a couple of patients come and ask me, we have the option of taking one of the vaccines. Both options are available to me. Which one would you recommend? Dr. Samaria, if I have the option of giving you both vaccines, which one would you take yourself and why?
In fact, it is a difficult.
I do not want to listen to data. I do not want to listen to what available literature about the efficacy and side effects are concerned. I want to know which vaccine would you take.
Like you, I also received the Covishield, but I wanted to take the Covaxin because it is a full viral vaccine.
Correct.
Complete inactivated virus is there, so it is good to have complete immunity against the incoming virus.
Correct, Madam Unje.
Prefer Covaxin only because it has a complete dead virus. And why we do that, because why we would prefer is the explanation which I believe in is that because it's a complete virus, perhaps it may offer me protection from various mutant viruses which are now coming into picture. That is first and foremost.
Great.
That's what I believe. Somebody.
Correct. Ravi bhai. Do you think this vaccine, when I talk about whole Viron, would elicit polyclonal antibodies, kind multiple antibodies, it would multiple antibody response it would elicit versus a monoclonal response, which probably if you have a single target would elicit? Do you think there would be difference in this antibody productions?
The antibody production will be very much monoclonal only, sir. It is a very specific protein which is being used by this particular technology, and only if that live virus, attenuated live virus thing, a virus is used, vaccine is used, then it may be polyclonal. But otherwise, usually it is a monoclonal response.
Okay. Dr. Samaria, sir, you are part of various neighboring countries' associations as well. And you have been playing active role in guiding them as well. I want to know your views on recommending vaccination to neighboring countries. What do you think are the recommendations with neighboring countries? I know that we have provided vaccines to neighboring countries, and we must salute our Prime Minister and our authorities for their decision of helping neighboring countries. But what are your views?
In fact, we are far ahead from the neighboring countries. We have vaccinated almost, our population have received almost 7 crores of the vaccination doses.
Yes.
But for your surprise, the Bangladesh has received almost 53 lakhs vaccine, which is again provided by the India.
Wow. And
what about the Pakistan? Only 8 lakhs doses have given to the Pakistani population, whole of the population.
Wow.
So this is what is required. In fact, neighboring country also equally important for us to get the vaccination.
And what do you think in our country, the strategies that, sir, we are following, do you think it's correct? I think only 3 or 4% of the population is currently vaccinated, if I'm wrong. You think, what are the ways of improving this vaccination? I mean, how can we vaccinate more number of people in a faster way?
Our Chief Minister, UP Chief Minister, said that they are going to double the vaccination doses from the 8th of the April. So the increase in vaccination, depending on the availability of the vaccine doses, we as far as we can increase the dose. But the again, the advising to the 45 plus and the, again the 30, 45 or less than 45 when we go to fourth phase, we go for the 30 year to 45 year with the comorbidities, because huge population is there. Now the what is happening at vaccination center, you know, neighboring to my place, the vaccination is over by the 12 o'clock, 12 noon. 12 o'clock, they start 10 o'clock, 12 noon, all the vaccination is over. They said our doses is over. So much rush is there. And now I'm happy to note that Indian population is going for vaccination now outrightly with the surge of second wave.
Correct. I'm very happy to announce that we've crossed 1,000 mark, and we have more than 1,000 delegates today who have joined in. And you know, I thank all the delegates who spared your valuable Sunday evening to be with us, because it's only your presence that encourages us to do more and more program. You know, your presence probably adds flavor to our discussion, and I am waiting for my chat box to be full. I want all of you to, you know, ask questions as much as possible. I promise to you that I will take up every question that comes up in my chat box. Dr. Munja wants to say something. Yes, madam.
I wanted to say something, that we have covered less number of people because in spite of having eagerness, everybody was awaiting the vaccine like a magic wand. Everybody thought the vaccine would come and corona would disappear. But once the vaccine came, and with all this knowledge that we have because of the ITs and all, there has been noted a lot of vaccine initiation hesitancy. And even the healthcare workers turned out only to the tune of 50%, you know.
Correct.
Many of the healthcare workers did not come
not to take vaccine. Yes.
Even if their names were in the list and they were made a call and messages were sent. Now, as Dr. Samaria sir is saying, at many places, the timing of vaccination has been doubled. So they work in two shifts. They start at 9 o'clock in the morning and work till 10 o'clock at night, so that more and more number of people are covered, as well as the rush at the vaccination center can be avoided. Plus, we are adding more and more number of vaccination centers also. Earlier, it was only the government or the public health facilities which were used. Now, many of the private clinics which are affiliated are offering vaccination. And they are not charging much. 250 rupees is the only charge which they can ask for. And many of the NGOs, if they are running hospitals, they offer free of cost. This vaccination is free day at their site. So I think increasing the number of centers is the only answer which we have to it.
Correct.
Provided what I started when I started speaking, is that the cold chain is maintained till the end. I mean, till the person gets the vaccine, if till that point the cold chain can be maintained, training is carried out, and the quality assurance is done, then only I think the vaccination program would not only increase numbers, but it would be successful to the tune that we want it to be.
Great. We have our ex-president and founder, Dr. N.H. Krishna, here with us, and he's doing exemplary work in Davangiri. And he is bored of answering this question. You know, he has at least 10 patients coming up to him every day and asking him, sir, I have diabetes. I have blood pressure. I'm on Ecosprin. I had some doubtful heart disease a decade ago. And can I take this vaccine? He's beautifully answering those patients, but he wanted, you know, to record a message from our panelists. And he felt that if somebody could give a proper answer, he would record it and play it every time any patient asks him this question. So I think who better than Dr. Doshi? Ravi Bhai, will you tell me, are there any absolute contraindications to vaccination?
The only absolute contraindication to the vaccination is allergy from the vaccination itself.
And have you seen any?
None whatsoever.
Okay.
So I tend to put it that way, that the more the number of diseases you have, the more you should be ahead in the line to get the vaccination done.
That's correct. Dr. Samaria, would you think of any contraindication to vaccination?
No.
I hear a lot of things about patients vaccine inducing a thrombotic state. we hear a lot of things about patients getting strokes and patients getting thrombovascular complications following vaccination. Do you think there would be any contraindication, relative contraindication, or would you want to?
No. I don't think any contraindication is there. These are not the contraindication. In fact, those countries who are banned, they again started it. The Spain and France again started AstraZeneca vaccine. So the specific as such, there is no contraindication except those who are already patient, they should not receive it.
So only active disease is a relative contraindication. So if you have a COVID suspect or if you have any febrile illness going on, probably refrain from giving him the vaccine unless it is absolutely mandatory. Say you have, I can't think of any situation, but suppose you come across any situation where it is absolutely essential to give him that vaccine, go ahead and give them vaccine. Only thing is the response may not be good. You may not have the adequate antibody response, and that could be a relative contraindication, but there cannot be any absolute contraindication to vaccination. Madam, that makes me ask you, have you seen any side effects except for the acceptable side effect, that is local site reaction and fever? Any other side effect that you have seen which you would attribute it to vaccine in your experience of last
I have really not seen any of the unusual side effects. For that matter, even I have not seen severe allergies, except for one patient who, after 24 hours of vaccination, said that he had something swelling around lips. And for that, I asked her to go to a physician and remain under observation, just to see whether this was a delayed allergic reaction or is it an unusual anaphylaxis which she's getting, because swelling of the lips and tongue, I don't perceive it as a very, low level side effect. But fortunately, with antihistamine, she was better and it did not advance.
Okay. And with the permission of... With the permission of this patient who is currently holding a very important post at IMA headquarters, you know, a doctor himself and a very senior physician, my very close associate. In fact, I spend every day morning with him. He got 6th nerve palsy following vaccination. Okay, he took Covishield and after about 4 weeks, he got isolated 6th nerve palsy. He had, probably absence of vision. I am not too good in neurology as well, so I do not know those terms. But then he had loss of vision of periphery on one of the eyes, and he underwent all possible investigation, and the neurologist said that possibly it could be a vaccine related complication. But apart from that, I also have not encountered any major side effect, except a lot of these patients are coming up with COVID infection after about 1 month, 1.5 months. A lot of these patients are getting COVID in spite of taking both doses of vaccine. Ravi bhai, what do you think? Is this vaccine related probably immune reaction, or it is probably what we discussed earlier, the overcrowding at the vaccination, or it is just a chance that since it is so prevalent in community, people are getting this infection?
Primarily, I think that it is all the high prevalence of the virus now in the community that they are getting that infection. But it is an attenuated response because of the vaccine, because a lot of such patients are just having high grade fever, 2-5% involvement in the CT, and they are improving after maybe some 5-7 days. They are not going to the whole course of the disease. But yeah, there could be, the only thing about COVID is everything from remdesivir to tosi to vaccine, we have come to understand with time. So maybe it is something vaccine induced, which we are
yet to understand. Correct.
To understand.
Correct. Great. Allow me to ask you a question. How long it takes for antibodies to develop? You know, Dr. Narayan, when I read literature, it tells me that it takes about 4 to 6 weeks for antibody titers to come up. And then when you give a second shot, probably 90-95% is the booster response. So is there any particular timeline that would be required for antibodies to develop? And suppose if antibodies don't develop, you have those patients who are very, very enthusiastic in knowing about this and they don't develop antibodies, would you recommend them a third booster by any chance?
Regarding antibody titer, it is after the booster dose. We expect it to be within maximum, as you told us by the literature, it is around 4 weeks we are expecting.
Correct.
And regarding the those who are not getting the antibody titer, we are not not have much recommendations as of now.
Correct.
What we have to do. Anyway, before I think you will be stopping and you will not be giving me any more chance now. Already 9:15.
Correct.
Yeah, so I will before I stop talking. First of all, I thank Chest Council of India to giving me an opportunity to participate in this.
Oh, don't discussion. Go away. We have a lot of questions for you. Where are you going?
No, I am not going anywhere.
Oh, okay. I thought you started Thanksgiving, so you want me to shut down now.
Number two, the take-home message should be, we should not miss the jungle for the tree. We should not confuse the people with the type of the vaccines. And we should not give much, my message should be very clear. You should get vaccinated above the age of 45. The more the comorbidities, more the, you should come up first. And there are very less side effects. It is safe. That message is very clear from the today's discussions.
Correct. That's a perfect message.
And third thing is the involvement of the NGOs. Like IMA is now planning for the on World Health Day, organize a World Health Day. And that's April 7th. We are IMA, that Indian Medical Association, is planning everywhere. I think in Kerala, it is, we are starting with every IMA branch, we are giving vaccinations through with the government support. And IMA is supporting the vaccination process. And every branch, we are doing the activity as the part of the World Health Day organization. So that's NGO, perfect, involvement of the NGOs, point. And this should be come forward, and private-public partnership should be there, so that correct. Vaccination process will be more, and it will affect, it will have more coverage. That should be the message from today's till now. And anyway, questions we have to answer.
Great. Dr. Pradeep, that's a perfect point. In fact, I had a meeting with Dr. Jayalal today, who's the national president IMA. In fact, I was talking to Dr. Lele also. He is the secretary, national secretary of IMA. And IMA is committed for vaccination. In fact, you would be happy to know that IMA has published a book on life course immunization, which was published, which the project started by Dr. Ravi Vankhedkar. Dr. Munje knows him very well. And it was started 2 years ago, and I was part of that project. We've come out with those guidelines, which are available for free download on the website. Luckily, I was part of the vaccination guideline by API also. Luckily, I was part of the vaccination guideline by Geriatric Society of India also. And I'm sure CCI will soon publish their own guidelines. And I look upon Dr. Krishna and Naren Pradeep to guide us to probably, formulate our own guidelines, our own recommendations. But till the time that is available, what he said is absolutely right. We need not measure antibody titers. Two vaccinations are enough. And as of now, we have no understanding on booster vaccination if there is inadequate antibody production. As Dr. Samaria said right in the beginning, it is the memory cell, it is the T cell activation which is more important, and it would come in action once you have a repeat infection. Also, the antibody titers depend on a variety of things. It depends on your overall status. It depends on your hemoglobins. It depends on your proteins. It depends on your control of diabetes and hypertension. It depends on your underlying liver and heart condition. It depends on your underlying smoking conditions, and et cetera, et cetera. There are various things on immune reactions or the response of body to immunity. I want to ask you about what are the vaccinations in pipeline. Do you think if we have future vaccines available, say if I have Johnson & Johnson vaccine tomorrow, or if I have any other vaccine for that matter tomorrow, say tomorrow I have a Zydus vaccine which is available, which is our own Indian vaccine available tomorrow, what do we do? Dr. Munje, do you think we should take any other vaccine if it is available as well? Like, things can be, I want to complicate it further by saying you that you have Prevnar 13 available, you have a Pneumovax 23 available. We did not know what to do, so we came out with beautiful guidelines that give both. And similarly, now you have different vaccines. You have a vector-based vaccine available, you have a whole viral vaccine available, you have different technology vaccines available. What would you do? What do you think would be there in pipeline, or what do you think future holds for it?
As of now, once you take a vaccine, the booster which you take should be of the same vaccine.
Correct.
If you cannot have Covishield as the first dose and then Covaxin as you do in the further pneumococcal vaccination. So that is an absolute no-no as of now. we do not have clear guidelines whether we need a booster after another 8 months or 1 year to offer further protection, and whether such type of crossover can be done at that time. I think we need a good evidence, good data on such crossover trials if they are done, as are usually done for other randomized controlled trials for drugs where crossovers are done. If at all we have such evidence that there is no complex immunological reactions and such vaccine can be tolerated and offers a better immunity, a better protection among by the incoming various mutants that we are getting or different forms of diseases that we may get, we do not know what's there in the future. If at all we get data, then perhaps we can make a recommendation. As of now, you stick to the vaccine that you have taken and be loyal to it.
Thank you. That's a perfect message. You know, Dr. Krishna is very influential, and he had a soft corner for this Pfizer vaccine, and he wanted to take the vaccine. You know our NHK, when it come to his mind, he would do it. So he flew to Dubai to take the vaccine. Only he can do it, you know. But he did it. And now he's well protected, and you know, like it's almost 15 months and he's been treating more than 1,000 patients every month, and still he did not get any infection. Would you recommend this kind of vaccination? Certain vaccines which are not available in my country, in our country, do you have faith on some other technologies, some other vaccine? Dr. Samaria, you may be the right person to enlighten us on that. In your opinion, out of all those available vaccines, would you put your personal favor on certain technologies, on certain vaccines over the vaccines that are available in our country?
You know, the many technologies are available. The Pfizer vaccine is a messenger RNA technology. So it may not be very necessary to prove that and take the risk to the, go to the Dubai or some any other place or any other country. I don't advise to anyone to travel to take the vaccination only, because to travel itself is get the risk of the getting the infection. Number one. Number two, our vaccines, the Covaxin or Covishield, are very pretty safe and easily available in our country. So it is always advisable to receive the vaccine here itself, then to move or fly to the any other country for taking vaccination only.
Great. Ravi bhai, I was so scared when I read for the first time that you cannot have alcohol for 45 days when you take vaccine, and I almost had heart attack. And I did not take vaccine, of course, because I mean, who would want to stay away from alcohol for 45 days? And then probably I got wiser and got, but then a lot of my friends here want to know your views on the, you know, avoiding alcohol with vaccine. What would you recommend?
Alcohol should absolutely be avoided at any point of time.
Kya baat karta hai? Come on.
Sir, number one. Number two, after vaccination, definitely you have to advise to avoid alcohol for 3 weeks. Now, whether you avoid it or not, that is another issue. But you have to advise to avoid it, because some immunity changes are induced by alcohol, which can alter the immune response elicited by the vaccine. Now, rest I leave up to the person's goodwill. That is all I can say.
You know, when Ravi bhai is talking about this, you know, you have seen him making this political and diplomatic talks in last couple of months. I can see him, you know, his change in the style since over a decade, probably his presentation and talking style has completely changed. While he's talking to me, he sends me a personal message, you know, and he says that in India, there are two category of people. You know, one, those who abuse Modi ji daily. And the other who abuse Rahul Gandhi ji daily. But apart from these two categories, there is third category of people who drink 180 ml of liquor daily and sleep with peace of mind. And a recent research provides that this third category of people are the happiest in the world. For them, past was achhe din. For them, present is also achhe din. And for them, future is also going to be achhe din. And he tells me that try to be among one of them. So bother about Covishield, don't bother about Covaxin, just have that 180 ml daily and have fun. That is what the message is sent in. So this is what is Ravi Bhai all about.
Shall I add something?
Yes, madam.
Yes. I'm not biased. One thing. Towards alcohol. For anybody else. But I would like to add that whenever your patient, this is for the message to go to everybody who is listening. Anybody who asks about alcohol, especially your patient, if he asks about alcohol, you have to explain to him that moderation is the key. Because if alcohol is really abused after vaccination, apart from the scientific know-how about the immunology or the immunity which is affected, you have to understand the side effects of the vaccine may not be perceived by that person. And if at all the side effects are severe, it's not good to ignore them. And that is why stay away from alcohol. I remember there was a message about 45 days of alcohol should not be used. And then it was circulated with so much of speed. And it was also in the newsprint and all. But at least for a week or so can be advised to your patient. And they would be wise enough to follow it in moderation.
Madam, I got another message which talks about how much do you contribute to nation. You know, imagine a situation where you donated 2,000 rupees to PM or CM relief fund. Okay. And imagine you bought a whiskey bottle worth 2,000 rupees. What do you think is the major contribution? On bottle of 2,000, you get 30% of tax rebate. Therefore, you actually ended up earning back 600 rupees. In other words, by donating 2,000, you made a net contribution of 1,400 rupees. On alcohol, the total tax, that is excise and GST added up, is 72% of MRP. So when I paid 2,000, 1,440 rupees went to state and 12.5 pegs of pleasure from 75 ml of whiskey bottle came to me. Therefore, not only did I contribute more, I created job at distillery, their suppliers, labels, bottles, caps, machineries, jobs at marketing companies, jobs at wine shop, and moreover, I was high in spirits doing so. And when you pay it to CM and PM fund, you do not know where that money goes. So think next time when you buy a bottle of whiskey, because you are serving to nation. That is what is the message, you know, that I have. Your views on it.
Dr. Agam, I agree with the spirit of spirit. But I would say that withholding for 1 week is better than to go under a lockdown for another 3 months.
Want to say that be a responsible citizen and contribute to nation as much as you can. Thank you very much for your time. Dr. Pradeep has already given me that you have already, used your time and I have only 2 minutes. So before I wind up, I would want to have a take-home message from everybody. And if Krishna is there, I would want Krishna to come on screen. Begin with the senior most doctor, Dr. Samaria, who's with us. Samaria, sir, your take-home message.
I think my message is to the people, those who are listening, that they should advise their patient to take the vaccine regularly and as per schedule, because the vaccine is the only way to control this pandemic.
Thank you, sir. Madam Unje?
Yes, I would say a big yes for vaccine for anybody who asks for it and anybody who has any hesitancy that must be solved or resolved by the treating physician or the family physician or whosoever is the medical advisor for that particular person. And we must encourage vaccination. We must encourage to increase the speed of vaccination which is needed. We were lucky that we started with vaccination when this COVID wave was very, very low. And we were very happy that it was introduced at the right time. Only because we could not cover a larger number, and now that the spike has already come, the effects of vaccine, we would take a longer time to look into it.
Thank you, madam.
It must be encouraged every time, at every point.
Thank you very much, madam. Dr. Ravi bhai, your take home message?
Vaccination karwana hai. It's good for you. And that's the only way that we are going to defeat COVID. That's all.
Correct. Dr. Sashikant?
Yes, sir. vaccination is must. Don't bother about the availability of Covishield or Covaxin. Go with whichever vaccine is available. Right now, we feel that Covaxin is better, but in later stages, we are still at the early stage. Later, we may feel that Covishield may be a better one. So don't bother about the type of vaccine. Whichever is available, go ahead with the vaccination. Motivate.
Great. And last word by Dr. Pradeep. Dr. Narayan.
Yes, my message is, as I told, we need to support our government as responsible citizens of India, as you told, not by spirit, but with the true involvement in the active immunization vaccination drive through the IMA, through the, our Rotary. Many of our members are Lions members. They are, many are in the Rotary. Many are having a lot of other trust members. So doctors are the actually limelight, and they are the people who can really guide to post the photos of you actually in the Facebook or in your social media. You motivate the people and you make that everybody vaccinate, and there should not be any hesitance. It is like same like taking your food, taking your routine work. The vaccination should go. In that way, if we can help our administrations, our government, then we will be easily, we can achieve our target, and we will have a win-win situation in our country.
Great. I see Dr. Krishna here. Before I ask Dr. Krishna to give his final word, I must thank the Chest Council of India for giving me this opportunity to host this particular, moderate this particular program, and those 1,000+ delegates. Ah, I love you for your presence, your inputs, and those questions that you've shooted there. I'm sorry I could not take up all the questions, but I promise to you, I would go to all this faculties and would take their answers and would post those answers to you. Krishna, I came across a message.
Yes.
That can cure COVID and bring world peace. You know, I'm sure this must be a fake news, but why take chance? Cheers.
Okay. Agam. Having Agam in the actually making him the moderator or making him a faculty in a CCA webinar, no? It's like amazing. That's like, no, you win the battle at the first blow itself. So the way he's humorous, the way he talks, the way he manages things, it's all absolutely brilliant. And I'm very happy that Agam, you did a fantastic job.
Thank you.
The icing on the cake is the presence of Samariya sir. Samariya sir, namaste.
Namaste.
Sir, I was not prepared, sir. So suddenly, Agam, no, he's someone to drag in someone like just for a glass of whiskey also. The way he drags someone, no, he drags someone like this. So I was not prepared. All of a sudden, I had to come online. And Samariya, sir, you were amazing, sir. And thank you so much. We are privileged to have a legend like you in CCI, sir. Thanks. Thank you. Brilliant, sir. You are brilliant, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna. I am really happy to be part of the CCI.
Sir, the pleasure is equally ours, sir, CCIs. And Radha Munje, ma'am, you were like brilliant.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And having you always is like having beauty with the brains. You were absolutely brilliant.
It's a privilege to be in the CCI family as well as to be in this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir, Samariya, sir, you were telling something in the meanwhile. I was unable to hear. Samariya, sir.
I was just telling that it is, I'm happy to be part of the CCI family.
Sir. Thank you, sir. Ravi, brilliant, our present secretary, and brilliant. You are a legend in Indian pulmonology regarding COVID. You have treated thousands and thousands of people in COVID, and you are an expert in that. Thank you so much, Ravi. Yaar, thanks for your presence.
Thank you. Jai Shri Krishna.
Jai Shri Krishna. Narayan Pradeep. Narayan Pradeep.
Thank you.
I'm here. I'm here.
That's a message,
thank
you so much.
Krishna. Thank
you so much. We don't want you to do this Thanksgiving, Ray.
No. When I have come here, I should thank everyone who has present. Narayan Pradeep, thank you so much. And Dr. Shashikant Jayu, absolutely brilliant job. Thank you so much. Now, the take-home message is, should I please the people or should I please Agam? That is the very important thing here. So, if you had to please Agam,
people and say cheers to me.
That's what. You have to please people, then I will tell that it's so nice. Actually, the take-home message is very perfect. What Narayan Pradeep said, the vaccine should be given to everyone, irrespective of whatever they have dilemma in their brains. See, the vaccine, I will tell you a very important take-home message. A vaccine doesn't prevent an illness. It only makes you not to have a severe illness. That everyone should understand. It doesn't prevent an infection. Okay, so it only prevents the chance of a severe illness. So taking vaccine is always a wiser step. And we advocate from CCI side that everybody should take the vaccine. And after the age of 45 years, as of now, later, I am very sure that will come down to 30 plus also. So all those, especially the healthcare workers, and regarding whatever it is, the alcohol phenomenon and the interaction, whatever it is, no, to take the vaccine is better than not taking it. That we have to strongly tell to everyone. Taking the vaccine is better than not taking it. Okay. So the message to Agam is, yes, Agam, of 1 week span or 7 day span or whatever Radha Munja has told, we can go ahead with your theme of alcohol also. So everybody is covered here, I believe now.
Great. Thank you very much. I would end by saying that over last 15, 16, 17 months, my body has absorbed so much of soap and so much of disinfectants that off late, when I go to washroom to pee, it cleans the toilet. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everybody, for your time. Thank you very much, everybody, for your presence. Samaria, sir. A special thanks to you for your presence, your wisdom. Thank you, Madam Munje. Of course, Narayan Pradeep, Ravi and Srikant are my mates. And Krishna, for your last minute appearance. Thanks. See you all.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, Dr. Agam.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay, we are off now. If you want, you can communicate among us.
Krishna, sir, it was a wonderful theme. And almost everything related with vaccine was covered.
Dr. Vijay Kumar, that was required. Very good demand of the situation it was.
Yes. A big thank you to Dr. Vijay Kumar also.
Yes, Vijay should never be forgotten. Vijay, he is the one to execute.
How much energy Dr. Narayana Pradeep has. He had a webinar in the afternoon. Somewhere around 3 o'clock you had a webinar today. And then again he is here. And Ravi Doshi, though, I was told that he worked like a resident. He worked like a resident during COVID times.
Yes,
even
yes,
when
yes,
he absolutely. Was not well, he was putting IV, taking care of the patients. Hats off.
Yes.
So thank you. Shall I sign off now?
Yes. Let's all share this enough. Thank you, everyone. Huh? Good night.
Bye. Good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Krishna, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Pradeep. Yeah. Thank you, Shashikant. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Bye, ma'am. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Long live CCI family.
Yes. Long live CCI family. Long live CCI family.